Yeah. Going 155 miles per hour. Life comes at us. Life. So many ways. Yeah. I just hope I live to see tomorrow. Please, God. God, keep me. I'm going full speed ahead. Man, I'm in the zone. Feels like I got my head stuck in a cyclone. I'm on a roller coaster ride. Trying to hold on, but I lost my grip on the handrails. I'm so gone. Life comes at us faster than a speeding bullet. My emotions had triggers. Please don't pull it. It took my mama 9 months just to make me. It took some idiot 30 seconds just to take me. Split decisions got me painting vivid pictures. Bible on my nightstand. Keep my head in the scriptures. Please forgive me, God. I know my flesh is weak. Temptations got me strolling street, but I cannot retreat. The devil's so busy. All these haters and these demons really trying to get me, but I won't let them stick me. I gotta stay strong. Operator, please get God on the phone.
Going 155 and I don't know why I'm still alive, but I do what I can. But I know I can't take anymore.
Hey, I'm beast.com.
I'm on this lonely road. Control and I can't slow down. I'm going 155 miles per hour. I'm reaching for the clouds, trying to touch the sky. And I pray to God it don't pass me by. I'm going 155 miles per hour.
Greenville's here today. Everybody's come a long way to see this show. Everybody came a long way to see these talks. And I tell you right now, I feel good this morning. How many of y'all feel good? Put your hands together this morning. All right, guys, I transformed from Superman. Like the creepy business guy. Wow. Love you, Mark. Sharing new stories in the community, I've come a long way in my life. I come from a place where people are looked down upon, frowned upon, the neighborhood I grew up in. And a lot of people in my neighborhood inspired me to do a lot of things in my life. It was very rough growing up. My grandmother raised me. I didn't see my mother that much. Never knew my father. And I had three things in my life that I wanted to make sure drove me to be better in life. Motivation. Next, inspiration, and dedication. Jesse Jackson Townhomes was founded in 1952. Interesting thing, my grandmother was one of the first 20 residents to move in 1952 during the winter. The crazy thing about it is that she raised my mother, my uncles, and my aunts in the same apartment that I was raised in since I was 2 weeks old. Talk about stability, right? And no matter how bad the community was, it didn't seem that bad to me. But for people on the outside, like, hey, I'm not going through there. I don't care if you were black or white, or Puerto Rican or Hispanic. They were not going to ride through there. It was like they had the car shows on Sundays. People had chairs sitting on top of the roofs. What's going on? This is a circus? And we would have these amazing car shows, and they would go from like the whole strip you see right there all the way to Cleveland Park and Reed River. I was like, oh my God, how these people got all these fancy cars, but they live in a two-bedroom shack? Well, it was just something that people in the community felt like made them feel better if they could buy expensive things and really not care about where they lived at because they were comfortable. There was something I call a poem. Not a poem, but a poem. A product of my own environment. Yes. One of the people, let's get to the inspiration. The motivation was me being a dreamer and getting out and wanting to do better in my life. One of my inspirations was Miss Mary Nan, rest her soul. This lady was like the president of Jesse Jackson Townhomes. No matter what she did, people knew her all over in all of the subdivision communities. I mean, Mary Mel was a person that she would get us up early in the morning. She would send her nieces to come and get me, right? And we would march down to the community center, and she had picket signs that say, up with hope, down with dope. And we're out there in our pajamas, and you know the little tight thermals? Up with hope, down with dope. Can I get a juice box? Like, eat some fruit. What fruit gonna do? My apple's got water in it. So people feared Mary Nell. I mean, even the cops, I would just sit like, sometimes I'd be in the middle court where she lived at, right? And I go up there and I'm like, oh my God, cops are out there. I'm gonna go back, turn back around. I don't know what's going on. And you see the cop, like, see Mary Nell on the porch, like, oh my God, I'm gonna be back up Mary Nell's here. And people were just like, she just come out. What's your problem? It's like, up Mary, you almost thought that she was gonna take this cop by his ears and come up on my porch and read Bible scriptures. Because she would take us and read Bible scriptures to us on her front porch. I mean, if you were about to get kicked out of your house, you didn't pay your life bill, your rent was due, I mean, that's your fault. But Mary Nell would help you out. People would go to her, and she'd be on her paper. I mean, she'd be on her porch every Sunday with a stack of papers and her Bible. I was like, how does she know, city, congressman? How does she know these people? You know, and she just had a way of talking to people. And that's what it is, you know, when you're talking to people, sometimes you can persuade them if you seem like they're professional. You don't even have to be professional. I mean, look at me. But Mary Nell had a way of talking to people, and I remember her niece used to get into a fight all the time, and the kids were like pick on her because she was Mary Nell's daughter, you know. And so they'd be outside like, oh, go get your mom, I don't care, what you got to tell Mary Nell. And now I'm sitting there here, you better leave my niece alone. But she was a beautiful woman, and she did a lot for the community, and she was one of my inspirations. I'll tell you another story about another guy interesting. His name was Joe Richard. This guy was a beast. I mean, he was like 6'5", walked real slow, breathe, walked real slow. And he owned a store on the corner. He was a middle-class white man in a lower-class neighborhood. And this guy was like, God, no one would touch him. Like, all these drug dealers were like drive right past the store. I'm like, my goodness, is Joe gonna put a hit on these guys? They come, you know, stand around the store. And he was an inspiration to me because we would go to the store and he would have a story, a quote every day to tell the kids in the store. And I wanted to get my candy. I wanted my Jolly Ranchers and I wanted my sugar daddies. But I didn't want to go hear a speech from Joe Richard. And sometimes I try to get in the store and his son would work the counter. And when I walk in the store, I just want to have sugar daddies. Some crybabies and some solid apples, you know, and try to hurry up and get it before Joe came. Like, oh, where you going? Come here, little fat boy. Come here. What are you doing? Any more sweets? Here, eat some fruit. It's nutrition. Why is everybody telling me to eat fruit? So, Joe Richard kept a lot of the crime down in the neighborhood. I mean, before him, a lot of guys were trying to rob the stores in the surrounding areas. But what he would do is he would employ these drug fiends, and a lot of these guys, he let them mop the floor, wash the windows, whatever, anything he could do to keep them out of the streets. And it actually worked. So he was very well respected in the community. And it's funny, I took one of my good friends to this site a couple weeks ago, and I was giving her a tour of the store and all the memories and stuff. She's like, he's giving me a tour of a place that doesn't even exist. Creepy. You know, but I think she enjoyed it, and it kind of like touched her, you know, because when people build these relationships through sharing stories, it kind of makes them feel like they know you now. The mentorship program that I have, that's one of my artists, Joseph Garrett. He came to me when I moved back to Greenville in September and said, I love doing music, but I don't know what to talk about. I was like, just be you, talk about you, yourself, your life experiences. And so through my life experiences and the way I do music, telling true stories about my life, Joseph Gary decided to do the same. And through that, he's had success. Now, I've been all over the world. I've performed with some of the biggest artists. I've been with Universal Records, Sony Records, and I've seen a lot in the industry that I really didn't like. Bad contract after bad contract after bad contract. And I felt like, you know what? Dedication. I'm dedicated to coming back full circle to Greenville, to my city, taking these artists, nonprofit, teaching them, giving them the blueprint how to be successful in this music industry so this can't happen again. Now, I can't save the world. I can't save everyone, you know, but I know I can inspire some of these artists to be better. I can inspire them to be real and talk about authentic stories. Now, I know some of you were listening to the song in the beginning. I don't know if you listened to the lyrics very well, but The Lonely Road was a dark place in my life when I was in the military, and I felt like my life had spiraled out of control. And when you're going 155 miles per hour, you need to slow down. And I know a lot of you guys have been in that place in your life. And so I just wanted to give that little piece of me to you and see if you can feel where I'm coming from. The next thing I want to talk about is my idea. My idea, we're spreading, is taking these stories and transferring them to music. I noticed that my four-year-old daughters, they're twins. They wouldn't let me read them Princess and the Frog. But when I bought the DVD with the musical, they sat and they listened. Otherwise, they were all over the place. And I felt like, you know what? I can think of so many times where any of you were in college or high school, you heard a song and you made it remember where you been, where you were when you first heard that song, right? You was like, oh my God, man, me and Fred, we were on the ski slopes, and that was beautiful, you know? And those songs, if they are authentic stories, and you can relate to them, and you're like, I've been there before, I went through that. And music is a universal tool, iPods, even through Facebook, and Reverb Nation, and MySpace. Even if you want to go on a social network, most people play games and listen to people's music. And even though it's not on Twitter, because Twitter has only 140 characters, I'm very new to Twitter, but it's amazing. And you can put links up there to go to where? YouTube, Facebook, Reverb Nation. So no matter what you're doing, you're listening to music some kind of way because it makes you feel the way you felt when you first heard the song. And before I go, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to take a look at the person next to you. You don't have to stare and propose to them. And look into their eyes, because the eyes are the window of the soul, they say. And each and every one of you, no matter how old, young, race, color, gender, or none of that, have been through a walk through life that you may not have experienced, and you may not have experienced, but we all have a story to tell. And ladies and gentlemen, my road is no longer lonely, because I have all you guys. You've been an inspiration to me, and I hope I have that one to you. God bless.